Dear brothers and sisters, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Today we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of the Lord's Paschal Mystery, that's to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all the faithful, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city of our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that we, being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ the King in exaltation may receive the eternal Jerusalem through him, may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. When they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethphage, to the Mount of Olives, Jesus said to his disciples, he sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find an ass tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord has need of them.' And he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on an ass, and on a colt, the foal of an ass." The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the ass and the colt and put their garments on them, and he sat thereon. Most of the crowd spread their garments on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest." And when he entered Jerusalem, all the city was stirred, saying, "Who is this?" And the crowd said, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Dear brothers and sisters, like the crowds who acclaimed Jesus in Jerusalem, let us go forth in peace. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who as an example to the humility for the human race to follow, caused our Saviour to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering, and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God for ever and ever.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Lord has given me a disciple's tongue, so that I may know how to reply to the wearied. He provides me with speech. Each morning he wakes me to hear, to listen like a disciple. The Lord has opened my ear. For my part, I made no resistance, neither did I turn away. I offered my back to those who struck me, my cheeks to those who tore at my beard. I didn't cover my face against insult and spittle. The Lord comes to my help so that I am untouched by the insults. So too, I set my face like flint. I know I shall not be shamed. The word of the Lord. The response to the psalm, my God, why have you forsaken me? My God, why have you forsaken me? All who see me deride me. They curl their lips, they toss their heads. He trusted in the Lord, let him save him, let him release him if this is his friend. My God, why have you forsaken me? Many dogs have surrounded me, a band of the wicked beset me. They tear holes in my hands and my feet, I can count every one of my bones. My God, why have you forsaken me? They divide my clothing among them, they cast lots for my robe. O Lord, do not leave me alone. My strength, make haste to help me. My God, why have you forsaken me? I will tell of your name to my brethren and praise you where they are assembled. You who fear the Lord, give him praise. All sons of Jacob, give him glory. Revere him, Israel's sons. My God, why have you forsaken me? A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. His state was divine. Yet Christ Jesus did not cling to his equality with God, but emptied himself to assume the condition of a slave, and became as men are, and being as all men are, he was humbler yet, even to accepting death, death on a cross. But God raised him high and gave him the name which is above all other names, so that all beings in the heavens, on earth, and in the underworld should bend the knee at the name of Jesus, and that every tongue should acclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord. They stand to acclaim the gospel. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. Christ was humbler yet, even to accepting death, death on a cross. But God raised him high and give him the name which is above all names. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Then one of the 12, the man called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said,
"What are you prepared to give me if I hand him over to you?"
They paid him 30 silver pieces, and from that moment he looked for an opportunity to betray him. Now on the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus to say,
"Where do you want us to make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
And he replied,
"Go to so-and-so in the city and say to him, the master says, my time is near. It is at your house that I am keeping the Passover with my disciples."
The disciples did what Jesus told them and prepared the Passover. When the evening came, he was at table with the 12 disciples. And while they were eating, he said,
"I tell you solemnly, one of you is about to betray me."
They were greatly distressed and started asking him in turn,
"Not I, Lord, surely."
He answered,
"Someone who has dipped his hand into the dish with me will betray me. The Son of Man is going to his fate, as the Scripture says he will. But alas for the man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. Better for that man if he had never been born."
Judas, who was to betray him, asked in his turn,
"Not I, Rabbi, surely."
And Jesus answered,
"They are your own words."
Now, as they were eating, Jesus took some bread, and when he had said the blessing, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said,
"Take it and eat. This is my body."
Then he took a cup, and when he had returned thanks, he gave it to them, saying,
"Drink, all of you, from this, for this is my blood, the blood of the covenant, which is to be poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. From now on, I tell you, I shall not drink wine until the day I drink the new wine with you in the kingdom of my Father."
After psalms had been sung, they left for the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"You will all lose faith in me this night, for the Scripture says, I shall strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after my resurrection, I shall go before you to Galilee."
At this, Peter said,
"Though all lose faith in you, I will never lose faith."
And Jesus answered him,
"I tell you solemnly, this very night, before the cock crows, you will have disowned me three times."
Peter said to him,
"Even if I have to die with you, I will never disown you."
And all the disciples said the same. Then Jesus came with them to a small estate called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
"Stay here while I go over there to pray."
He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee with him, and sadness came over him, and great distress. Then he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful to the point of death. Wait here and keep awake with me."
And going on a little further, he fell on his face and prayed,
"My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass me by. Nevertheless, let it be as you, not I, would have it."
He came back to the disciples and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
"So you had not the strength to keep awake with me 1 hour. You should be awake and praying not to be put to the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Again, a second time, he went and prayed,
"My Father, if this cup cannot pass me by without my drinking it, your will be done."
And he came back again and found them sleeping. Their eyes were so heavy. Leaving them there, he went away again and prayed for the third time, repeating the same words. Then he came back to the disciples and said to them,
"You can sleep on now and take your rest. Now the hour has come when the Son of Man is to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us go. My betrayer is already close at hand."
He was still speaking with Judas, one of the 12, appeared, and with him a large number of men armed with swords and clubs, sent by the chief priests and elders of the people. Now the traitor had arranged a sign with them. He said,
"The one I kiss, he is the man. Take him in charge."
So he went straight up to Jesus and said,
"Greetings, Rabbi,"
and kissed him. Jesus said to him,
"My friend, do what you are here for."
Then they came forward, seized Jesus, and took him in charge. At that, one of the followers of Jesus grasped his sword and drew it. He struck out at the high priest's servant and cut off his ear. Jesus then said,
"Put your sword back, for all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Or do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father, who would promptly send more than 12 legions of angels to my defense? But then, how would the Scriptures be fulfilled that say, this is the way it must be?"
It was at this time that Jesus said to the crowds,
Am I a brigand that you have sent out, that you have set out to capture me with swords and clubs? I sat teaching in the temple day after day, and you never laid hands on me.
Now all this happened to fulfill the prophecies in Scripture. Then all the disciples deserted him and ran away. The men who had arrested Jesus led him off to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the scribes and the elders were assembled. Peter followed him at a distance, and when he reached the high priest's palace, he went in and sat down with the attendants to see what the end would be. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus, however false, on which they might pass the death sentence. But they could not find any, though several lying witnesses came forward. Eventually, two stepped forward and made a statement.
This man said, "I have power to destroy the temple of God and in 3 days build it up."
The high priest then stood up and said to him,
"Have you no answer to that? What is this evidence these men are bringing against you?"
But Jesus was silent, and the high priest said to him,
"I put you on oath by the living God to tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God."
And Jesus answered,
"The words are your own. Moreover, I tell you that from this time onward, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming on the clouds of heaven."
At this, the high priest tore his clothes and said,
"He has blasphemed. What need of witnesses have we now? There, you have just heard the blasphemy. What is your opinion?"
And they answered,
"He deserves to die."
Then they spat on his face and hit him with their fists. Others said as they struck him,
"Play the prophet Christ. Who hit you then?"
Meanwhile, Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard, and a servant girl came up to him and said,
"You too were with Jesus the Galilean."
But he denied it in front of them all, saying,
"I do not know what you are talking about."
When he went out to the gateway, another servant girl saw him and said to the people there,
"This man was with Jesus the Nazarene."
And again, with an oath, he denied it.
"I do not know the man."
A little later, the bystanders came up and said to Peter,
"You are one of them for sure. Why, your accent gives you away."
Then he started calling down curses on himself and swearing,
"I do not know the man."
At that moment, the cock crew, and Peter remembered what Jesus had said, "Before the cock crows, you will have disowned me 3 times. And he went outside and wept bitterly. When morning came, all the chief priests and all the elders of the people met in council to bring about the death of Christ. They had him bound and led him away to hand him over to Pilate, the governor. When he found that Jesus had been condemned, Judas, his betrayer, was filled with remorse and took the 30 pieces of silver back to the chief priests and elders, saying,
"I have sinned. I have betrayed innocent blood."
And they replied,
"What is that to us? That is your concern."
And flinging down the silver pieces in the sanctuary, he made off and went and hanged himself. The chief priests picked up the silver pieces and said,
"It is against the law to put this into the treasury. It is blood money."
So they discussed the matter and bought the potter's field with it as a graveyard for foreigners. And this is why the field is called the Field of Blood today. The words of the prophet Jeremiah were then fulfilled, and they took the 30 silver pieces, the sum at which the precious one was priced by children of Israel, and they gave them for the potter's field, just as the Lord had directed me. Jesus then was brought before the governor, and the governor put to him this question,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
And Jesus replied,
"It is you who say it."
But when he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he refused to answer at all. Pilate then said to him,
"Do you not hear how many charges they have brought against you?"
But to the governor's complete amazement, he offered no reply to any of the charges. At festival time, it was the governor's practice to release a prisoner for the people, anyone they chose. Now, there was at that time a notorious prisoner whose name was Barabbas. So when the crowd gathered, Pilate said to them,
"Which do you want me to release for you, Barabbas or Jesus who is called Christ?"
But Pilate knew it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. Now, as he was seated in the chair of judgment, his wife sent him a message.
"Have nothing to do with that man. I have been upset all day by a dream I had about him."
The chief priests and elders, however, had persuaded the crowd to demand the release of Barabbas and the execution of Jesus. So when the governor spoke and asked him,
"Which of the two do you want me to release for you?"
they said,
"Barabbas."
And Pilate said to them,
"What am I to do with Jesus who is called Christ?"
And they all said,
"Let him be crucified."
Pilate asked,
"Why, what harm has he done?"
But they all shouted the louder,
"Let him be crucified."
Then Pilate saw that he was making no impression, that in fact a riot was imminent. So he took some water, washed his hands in front of the crowd and said,
"I am innocent of this man's blood. It is your concern."
And the people, to a man, shouted back,
"His blood be on us and on our children."
Then he released Barabbas for them. He ordered Jesus to be first scourged and then handed over to be crucified. The governor's soldiers took Jesus with them into the praetorium and collected the whole cohort around him. Then they stripped him and made him wear a scarlet cloak. And having twisted some thorns into a crown, they put this on his head and placed a reed in his right hand. To make fun of him, they knelt to him, saying,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
And they spat on him and took the reed and struck it on his head with it. And when they had finished making fun of him, they took off the cloak and dressed him in his own clothes and led him away to crucify him. On their way out, they came across a man from Cyrene, Simon by name, and enlisted him to carry his cross. When they had reached a place called Golgotha, that is, the place of the skull, they gave him wine to drink. When they had finished crucifying him, they shared out his clothing by casting lots, and then sat down and stayed there, keeping guard over him. Above his head was placed the charge against him. It read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." At the same time, two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. The passers-by jeered at him. They shook their heads and said,
"So you would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Then save yourself. If you are God's son, come down from the cross."
The chief priests with the scribes and elders mocked him in the same way, saying,
"He saved others, he cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now and we will believe in him. He put his trust in God. Now let God rescue him if he wants him. For he did say, 'I am the Son of God.'"
Even the robbers who were crucified with him taunted him in the same way. From the sixth hour, there was darkness all over the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?"
That is,
my God, why have you deserted me?"
When some of those who stood there heard this, they said,
"The man is calling on Elijah."
And one of them quickly ran to get a sponge, which he dipped in the vinegar, and said, putting it on a reed, gave it to him to drink. The rest of them said,
"Wait, see if Elijah will come to save him."
But Jesus, again crying out in a loud voice, yielded up his spirit. At that, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth quaked, the rocks were split, the tombs opened, and the bodies of many holy men rose from the dead, and these, after his resurrection, came out of the tombs, entered the holy city, and appeared to a number of people. Meanwhile, the centurion, together with the others guarding Jesus, had seen the earthquake and all that was taking place, and they were terrified and said,
"In truth, this was a Son of God."
And many women were there, watching from a distance, the same women who had followed Jesus from Galilee and looked after him. Among them were Mary of Magdala, Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's sons. When it was evening, there came a rich man of Arimathea called Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate thereupon ordered it to be handed over. So Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean shroud, and put it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn out of the rock. He then rolled a large stone across the entrance of the tomb and went away. Now Mary of Magdala and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite the sepulchre. Next day, that is, when preparation day was over, the chief priests and the Pharisees went in a body to Pilate and said to him,
"Your Excellency, we recall that this impostor said, while he was still alive, 'After 3 days, I will rise again.' Therefore, give the order to have the sepulchre kept secure until the third day, for fear his disciples come and steal him away and tell the people he has risen from the dead. This last piece of fraud would be worse than what went before."
And Pilate said to them,
"You may have your guards. Go and make all as secure as you know how."
So they went and made the sepulchre secure, putting seals on the stone and mounting a guard.
This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So sit down for about 2 minutes. This is a big drama with many actors in it and many events. So I want you to think quietly for about 2 or 3 minutes on what strikes you about it. And then, since the drama is going to unfold over the whole of the next week, you could begin now to put yourself into it. Put yourself into the picture, identify with some of the characters, and talk to the Lord. And begin now for about 2 minutes. in doing that, you can let your imagination run wherever it leads you, and that's a form of prayer. So before we say the creed, I just share one reflection I had about it. A problem of our human condition is that we have violence in our hearts, right back from the story of Cain and Abel. Cain killed his brother Abel out of jealousy, and we're like that. Jesus' answer to it is non-violence. So in face of his immediate problem with the Pharisees and Pilate, but also the wider problem of the Roman Empire occupation of Jerusalem, there's always the threat of violence, but Jesus' approach was one of non-violence, right up to death. And that's something we've to learn. It's a way of loving. It's only in relatively recent, almost in the recent century, that we've even come to talk in terms of non-violence. Important for us because today is the 25th anniversary of the peace agreement, the Belfast Peace Agreement, where we moved from violence to peace. And we call it the Good Friday Agreement, so it has some resonances with the death and resurrection of Jesus. So we have to learn non-violence and receive peace from God. One form of non-violence that's very clear. On Thursday I passed by the roundabout of the hospital and people were out picketing for their salaries. That method is a method of non-violence. There are times in history when violence arose from conflicts of interest at the level of bread and butter. So that's a form of non-violence that we have learned to use. So let's ask the Lord to help us to grow in peace and reconciliation. Reconciliation is when we're able to live together in a civilized way and talk, negotiate, dialogue together when there is in fact conflicts of interest and conflicts of outlook, but we can live with it in a peaceful way. So let's stand now and say the creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray. Now we bring our needs and the needs of the world and place them before our God with full confidence that he loves us and always listens to us.
We pray for Pope Francis and all those entrusted by God with leadership roles within the Church. May they imitate the self-emptying love of Jesus. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for those persecuted throughout the world for speaking the truth, that the Lord may come to their help and that they may persevere in being prophets for our time. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for those who feel forsaken by God, that he will renew their faith in him and that we may never be blinded to their plight. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For ourselves during this Holy Week, that as we walk with Jesus on the way of the cross, we may follow him ever more closely and appreciate his great love and sacrifice for us. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for all those who suffer from illness of mind and body, and those who may be confined to their homes, that as they share in the suffering of Christ, they may also share in his glory. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us. We pray for those who are recently deceased, Rita McInally, Alicia Natsarova, and Dimpna Prunty. And for those whose anniversary occur today, Margaret Norden, Paddy McElinden, Jackie and Patrick Grimley, Jackie Grimley, Gaston de Vasconcelos. And for those whose anniversaries occurred yesterday, it's the month's mind of Pauline White and of Brian Kelly. And it's the anniversary of Dennis McGuigan, Francisco Victor Tavares, Filomena Miguel Suarez, and Vanessa Arroso Felipe. And for those whose anniversary occurred at this time, Cosme Dominguez and the Jimenez family, Antonio Pereira, and Teresina Fraga. May their souls and the souls of all the faithful departed, to the mercy of God, rest in peace. Heavenly Father, grant us the grace to persevere in living the Christian life so that we may share in the resurrection. We make our prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we've received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God.
This mystery. We come to share in the divinity of Christ, which is self to share. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we've received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours will be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that, though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that it may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, with Eamon, our Bishop, and Michael and Sean, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Let's stand and say the prayer that Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as you await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will. We live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's pause for a moment and say a prayer for peace for the person beside you. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. We are happy to be called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ keep me safe to eternal life. Father, if this chalice cannot pass without my drinking it, your will be done. A few notices. There'll be no adoration of the Blessed Sacrament this Holy Thursday. But on Tuesday coming, here in this church at 7:30 in the evening after 7 o'clock Mass, there'll be a penitential service. On weekly envelopes, you can collect your weekly envelopes at the back of this church here. And the extraordinary ministers of the Eucharist are invited to come and renew their commitment to this ministry during the Mass of the Lord's Last Supper on Holy Thursday in this church here. On Good Friday, there's a Holy Land collection, and it's in a blue envelope. And on the weekend of the 8th and the 9th of April, there is a collection in a pink envelope for the priest's dues. And then the Trochra boxes can be left at the back of both of the churches. So I hope you'll have a good Holy Week. Let us pray. Visit your people, O Lord, we pray, and with ever-watchful love, look upon the hearts dedicated to you by means of these sacred mysteries, so that under your protection we may keep safe this remedy of eternal salvation, which by your mercy we have received through Christ our Lord. May your protection, O Lord, we pray, defend the humble and keep ever safe those who trust in your mercy, that they may celebrate the Paschal festivities not only with bodily observance, but above all with purity of mind, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Mass is ended. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thank you, and have a nice week.